Okay, shalom, good evening. I think I'd feel better here and a little bit of connection with you instead of, we'll see how it works. Okay, so this evening I want to share my, what I consider to be an extraordinary journey that I embarked on 44 years ago when I took my first job teaching four-year-olds in a daycare center. That was in Boston, in the United States. My career trajectory has led me to various jobs with young children and eventually to training teachers, which is what I've been doing for the past 25 years in Israel. To becoming a researcher in the field of gender balance. And this current passion I have for learning about men who teach young children is what brings me here tonight. I'm going to put aside my personal narrative and focus on the narratives of the men that I've been researching. So let's begin by, I want to introduce you to Benny Haidloff. Benny's username on his email address is Magic Benny. This name captures his sense of wonder, his enthusiastic satisfaction with his work, and his extraordinary connection with the kindergarten children that he teaches in Basel, in Switzerland. His decision to become a kindergarten teacher was really quite deliberate. He knew throughout high school that he would not follow his parents' advice to become a clarinetist, but it took him many years from completing his compulsory army service at age 19 until he finally signed up for a kindergarten teaching course at age 27. In between, he worked as a clerk in a music store, then as a salesman, and for several years as a customer service agent for an international transport service. Although this last job comfortably supported his bachelor lifestyle, he felt unfulfilled. And he came home one day and he looked in the mirror and he asked himself, "So what did you do today?" And his answer really fell far short of his vision for his current life and for his future. So shortly afterwards, he noticed a newspaper ad for a kindergarten teacher training program. And this ad caused him to reflect on his current job at the transport company, comparing it to the role of the kindergarten teacher. And this is what he told me. He said, "The smile on the face of a child, it was better than 3 months of work at the transport company." And in retrospect, his decision to apply for the program and change his career direction seemed almost natural. He recalled his extensive background of work with children at his father's Catholic church in the small town of Arlesheim, where he grew up. As a teen, he had led youth activities in the church, and this experience set the tone for his resolution to seek a career working with children. He applied and was accepted to the training program. He quit his well-paid job, took out loans, and began his 2 years of study as one out of two men in a class of 30 women. This story really illustrates the promise and the problematics of men choosing to work in early learning. Benny's narrative points to his internal drive to find meaning in his work. His exceptional introspection, his ability to listen to the wake-up call, his ability to switch gears midstream is really most uncommon. Such men are few and far between. And it's clear why his father never thought of suggesting a career for young children for Benny, but it is unclear why this particular newspaper ad sparked his imagination and set his life off in another direction. So in my lecture this evening, I want to explore with you what I have learned from listening to the narratives of such men who choose to work with young children, and why listening to their narratives is so important for those of us interested in achieving gender balance in early learning. So I think Sarah's really covered a lot of the material that I wanted to talk about here. I'm going to make short work of this. Here you can see a comparison of a few countries. As you see, Norway here is at the top. Flanders here, you can see the increase from 1994 to 2014 over 20 years. Germany, we see this increase. What I have to say about Germany and this effort that Sarah was talking about is that it did bring some results, but for my colleagues in Germany who were involved in this program, they were disappointed. Right in Hamburg, where they worked, they got fantastic results, but over nationwide, they were only able to increase the participation up to almost 5%. It's pushing 5% now. and this was in spite of this tremendous investment in time, money, and professional expertise. The most interesting of these countries is Turkey, where you get this jagged line. But you know, why Turkey of all places? They're almost 6%. And this illustrates the importance of looking at the socio-cultural context of the situation of men in early childhood. What's happened in Turkey is that teaching in a school, in a kindergarten, doesn't matter if it's a kindergarten or a public school, it's a well-paid job. It's job stability, you get a good pension, and you don't get fired. You stay in the job for the rest of your life. And those jobs are very difficult to come by in Turkey, and it's attracted men for that reason. And one might think of Turkey as a place which may have, you know, fairly traditional values, but in spite of that, you know, these economic conditions have made it attractive. I was going to tell you about your own statistic here, but Sarah's done it, so I don't need to go into that. So we can move on to my country. Well, I'm not sure why my line turned out to be almost unreadable, but this kind of beige line is Israel. We have, and New Zealand looks great compared to my country. We have 0.0023. That is, we have 40 men out of 17,000 teachers, and that's in the Jewish sector, in the mainstream Jewish sector. In the Arab sector, it's zero. There's not a single Arab preschool teacher in the country. And however, there's something else very interesting here. In the ultra-Orthodox community, and I don't know if how familiar you are with the ultra-Orthodox, it's about 8 to 10% of the population, and these people live a very, very traditional lifestyle. all of the teachers of 3, 4, and 5-year-old boys are men, all of them, 100%. The children are segregated by gender from age 2, and this job is a man's job. A woman would not be allowed to teach there. this is, again, it shows the socio-cultural context and how much it affects what's going on. So this phenomenon, in fact, is going to be my next book. I'm fascinated by this group. They're the only men in the world that I can find who are working with young children doing a man's job. It's not a woman's job in that subculture. It's a man's job. So the only problem with researching is that they don't like people to come in and research. They don't like research. So I have to do a little bit of dressing up here. So what about research efforts? I'm going to just show you some of the different kinds of research that have come out in the last few years. One question is the big question, which we continually ask, is why are there so few men? I have to add that just 2 days ago, I read a research article from some researchers in South Africa who were looking at male pre-service teachers, students in the early primary department. And they were asking them why they didn't choose the early years track. And the it's fascinating. It has a lot to do with their views of masculinity. There are some international comparisons. This is between Germany and New Zealand, this particular study. There are comparisons of men and women teachers' perspectives on the significance of teachers' gender in the classroom. Comparison of men and women's practices and interactions with the children. And the whole question of role models is the other question that there's been a lot of research on is looking at school achievement and gender gaps in school achievement and trying to figure out is would increased male participation in the teaching force close the gap between the boys and the girls, because the girls are outperforming the boys. So there was this landmark journal, a special issue of the European Early Child Education Research Journal in 2015, totally dedicated to the question of gender balance. And Sarah has an article there. I have a couple of articles in this journal, and it's a fantastic source for people looking at looking for research in the field. There have been a few books. Over the years, stands out about these books is that they're either self-reported case studies where men tell their stories, or collections of essays or articles. Among them, there's only one. This one is actually a research report where he actually did a very comprehensive study of looking at male teachers. So, when I took this body of research into consideration, what I thought was lacking in this research was taking a look at what men's practice actually looks like. What does it look like when you go into a man's classroom? Is it different than when you go into a woman's classroom? How do men carry out their job working with young children? And surprisingly, nobody thought of doing that, going in and looking at what men do. And I thought that it was important to take an ethnographic point of view and to see how this informs the narratives of these men as told to an outsider. There I am. Okay. The second aspect lacking was an in-depth narrative interviews where men would be asked to tell their own stories in their own manner, in their own time frame. And the third aspect that I found missing was an international comparison of men, because I feel really strongly that the sociocultural context can help us understand a lot about what men are doing in the field. I posit that the cultural lens can shed light on the experience of men in early learning, on their decisions to work in the field, to stay, and to leave. Does masculinity look the same in different cultures? How do societies define boundaries of what is permissible for men and women in their work? How do different societies view childhood and the role of fathers in childcare? How do different cultures view men who choose to work with young children? I believe this perspective is crucial because men's work in early learning takes place within a socio-cultural context, which determines how their work unfolds and what are the limitations of their behavior vis-a-vis the children. Yeah. So all these considerations led me to a decision to look at men from different countries, and I chose six based on budget, accessibility, time constraints. That's why New Zealand's not down there at the time. I didn't have the funds to come down here and interview some of you guys who are sitting out here. And but I, with the, within the my own constraints, I tried to achieve as much breadth as I could. And the result is a study which extended over 2 years, 6 countries and 3 continents. The little red dots are the places I was able to get to. Maybe I'll do it like this. So what were my research aims? I'm interested in knowing what characterized the professional practice of men in early learning in different societies. How men come to work with young children, and how do these men understand and construct their professionalism? It's a qualitative study, multiple case study. I was interested in 2 things, what they said and what they do. So I, as a non-participant observer, spent a day in the classroom from the some time before the first child arrived until the last child went home. And I was just like a fly on the wall. And during breaks, I could ask the teacher what he said because I didn't speak all those languages. and then at the end of the day, I interviewed my subjects. It was a fairly lengthy interview, 2 to 3 hours, which was a narrative interview. And at the end of the narrative was followed by a semi-structured interview. And in addition, I interviewed work supervisors and the people in that country who are dealing with gender balance, gender balance experts, and other officials who are involved in the whole question. My particular population were these 6 men. I wanted veteran teachers. I didn't want men who were coming in and out in the first year or two. I wanted to know about men who had committed themselves to the work. And I got 2 nursery caregivers, 4 kindergarten teachers, and 2 were married, 2 in long-term relationships, 2 bachelors. They're the countries they're from, and those are their pictures. So let me just put these up and then I'll tell you about them. So I believed in the importance of involving my subjects in the research process as much as possible. Therefore, I spent quite a bit of effort establishing a relationship with them before I arrived, by telephone, by email, and encourage them to set the boundaries. When may I come to your class? Where do you want me to stand? May I use a video? May I photograph? And you know, whatever they said, I accepted as long as they were willing to let me be there for the day. And I also insisted that they read over the protocols and the completed chapter about themselves before I finalized my findings and conclusions. And I found that they were very interested in reading both the protocols, which was rather cumbersome with pages and pages of transcriptions, but they read everything and they said, no, I didn't really say that, I said this. So, you know, that was an interesting process. And then I gave them the chapter. I wrote a chapter about each man, and I gave them the chapter to read, and they really had a lot of changes they wanted me to make, corrections. Their understanding was not my understanding, and that's exactly what I wanted. I wanted to get their perspective. So, what did I learn? I'm going to share three different areas of the findings that I think are particularly of interest. The first is a picture of practice. What does it look like to be in their classroom? The second is their whole process of choosing to work in early child education. And the third is how do they construct their professional identity? So let's start out with pictures of practice. I was amazed at the commonalities. I didn't expect this. I thought that I was going to see a lot of different kinds of things. Well, I saw a lot of different kinds of things, but I also saw some astounding commonalities. The first was active involvement with the children. Every minute, they were active. I mean, in my country, in Israel, I spend a lot of time in kindergarten because I'm a clinical supervisor, so I've spent hundreds of hours, and I'm not used to seeing the kindergarten teacher actively involved with the children all the time. I mean, she's on there, you know, talking to her colleagues. She's on her cell phone. She's cutting triangles. She's doing a lot of things. There was this intense interest in what the children are doing, what they're asking, what they're wondering, what they're creating, and how they're playing. There was also this enjoyment of being with the children, just pleasure, enjoyment. And sometimes they talked about re-entering the world of childhood. I want to be a child. They were very interested in stimulating the thinking of children. And another found was reducing their own authority to allow room for the children to make decisions. They didn't need to be there controlling things. They were interested in finding out what the children wanted to do, what they wanted to learn about, and that. So I'm going to illustrate these principles with a 4-minute clip of Radar, my teacher from Norway. He's a nursery caregiver. Now, in my next reincarnation, I'm going to be a techie, and I'll be able to do this easily. But let's see if this works. Okay, I think if I do this. Oh, I'm sorry. There are 3 episodes. there's this episode with the child with the red bag, unpacking the red bag. There's an episode of a ball game and an episode of playing with these giant Legos. Okay. Whoops.
Thank you.
thing. Don't need this. Okay, so that's the kind of data I had to work with, and I think you can see in this in these three episodes that he was just totally involved with these children and totally interested in what they were interested in, able to connect with them intellectually, emotionally, and the other thing that it was really interesting is with this Lego stack at the end of the you talk a lot about scaffolding. I mean, he was literally scaffolding, and then of course enjoying their knocking it over at the end, which was great. So I'd like to so when I enter an early learning class with a female teacher, I don't normally expect to see her playing with children. I'm delighted when I do, and often I do see women play with children. But when I enter a class with a male teacher, after this research, I've come to expect play. I expect the men to see the men playing, and that's what I continually saw. I saw in my data this confirmation of this basic premise that I formulated over the years, that men in early learning like to play. And I'm going to skip this excerpt because it's there in the book if you want to see it, and it's I want to move on because I hope to, I really intend at the end of my presentation to give time to hear your thoughts, and I think that's really important as well. I just would like to add that there was one exception. I have a male teacher in the United States who's a Japanese American, and he's in an academic kindergarten. Most kindergartens in America are academic kindergartens, I'm sorry to say, and there was no play in his class. He allowed 25 minutes twice a week for the children to play, and otherwise they were sitting at tables, and that's pretty standard now. And when I say kindergarten in America, I'm talking about five-year-olds, the year before they enter first, before they start reading, though now they're teaching reading in kindergarten. So I think that's one of the casualties of this academization. Let's move on now to the second focus of my findings. That's choosing to work in early childhood. There are two critical issues that frame my analysis of why and how men choose to enter the profession. These issues highlight commonalities and differences between the men in my study. The first is this: looking at the significance, is the significance of choosing the profession expressive or is it instrumental? And the second is their decision a passive decision or is it the result of an active approach? And I found that this way of looking at their decision making, their decision to enter the profession, to be helpful in understanding who they are and what they're doing. So the first question about expressive or instrumental significance, while some of the men in my study were searching for personal meaning in their work, others were simply searching for a job. Benny serves as a hallmark of the meaning searcher. This quote that you've already heard this evening, I won't repeat it. So when Benny saw this advertisement that appeared in the newspaper, he was able to visualize the smile of the child. He was looking for meaning. But there is something else to keep in mind, that as I said, he had a very well-paid job, but in Switzerland, kindergarten teachers are very well-paid also. And so although he was taking a pay cut, it wasn't a terrible pay cut, and he knew that with his job as a kindergarten teacher, he was going to be able to support himself in the lifestyle that he was accustomed. But at the other extreme is this instrumental significance, which I found in my subject Leon, who's a nursery caregiver in London. At the age of 32, he found himself floating from job to job, from one quasi-academic training program to another. And the most steady employment that he had was playing bass guitar and an occasional gigs with a rock band called the Assassin's Poison. In contrast to Benny, who found the ad for himself for the training program, it was Leon's girlfriend who showed him an announcement for a brief training program for nursery caregivers. So both his girlfriend and his family encouraged him to apply. For Leon, the career choice made sense in terms of finding a job. And this is how he tells his story. I had no real particular focus in my life. I was kind of drifting around for a long time, and people said to me, "Have you ever thought of working with children? You seem to have a really good connection with them." That was because of his nieces and nephews who he liked to play with. And I suppose that I had never thought of working with children, particularly very young children. It's a job. But he's been there for, at this point, 14 years, the same nursery, and it's actually a, for him, it's a very good job. It's a steady job. He's got a pension. He's got, so it's a public kindergarten. And he's good at it. He's really good at it. And he exhibits these same characteristics as the other men, the focus, the interaction, the... So among my informants, I identified a third model which falls somewhere between these two extremes of meaning versus utility. This is Elton, my Japanese-American who I told you about a few minutes ago. He had been teaching kindergarten for 25 years when I came to visit him. He came to work with young children almost by chance. His trajectory is instrumental from start to finish. He began his studies in forest management until the bottom fell out of the economy in the United States, and there was fell out of the lumber market, and there was going to be no work for him. So his friend suggested, "Why don't you sign up for an education course in the university? You're already in the university. They have a nice education program. You can be a teacher." And so his planning was, okay, he's going to be a work in junior high school in America. That's 7th and 8th graders, like 11 and 12 year olds. And he's going to be a math teacher. He really likes math. And he's going to be a baseball coach, which he really likes. And what happened? It's a K through 8 program, and they assigned him to a kindergarten class for his student teaching. And he never left. So in contrast to Benny, who saw working with young children as inherently meaningful, or Leon, who simply needed a job, Elton intentionally negotiated his career decision pathway. For him, the job choice was utilitarian. He wasn't looking to teach the early years. However, once he found himself in the kindergarten class, he sought his own meaning within this career. And this is what he says. "So when I graduated, a kindergarten position opened up here at Jefferson School. It was half-time, and I took the job." By the way, there weren't any, it was very competitive to get a teaching job at that time, and this thing just opened up and he grabbed it. And then a first grade opened up, and I taught first grade for probably about 17 years, and then a kindergarten teacher retired, so kind of by default, I ended up in kindergarten, but I ended up enjoying it, and he really enjoys it. So that's kind of the in-between case. So in her classic book, Doing Women's Work, Christine Williams, this is really a classic, but it's from 1993. She was looking at men doing women's work in a lot of different professions. And she identified two models. One is called the revolving door, where men come in because they need a job or whatever, and then they go out. And the other is the trap door, where they kind of fall in. That's kind of what happened to our friend Elton. The revolving door posits a very active role in making the decision, as accompanied by a calculated plan to leave the profession either by shifting to a different occupation or by moving up the career ladder with what's well known as the glass escalator. Okay. So. So let's move on to the trapdoor. as I said, in Elton's case, it was the trapdoor. With the trapdoor model, the career seeker unintentionally finds himself working in a woman's profession because of unexpected circumstances. So I'd like to emphasize the elements of being active and being passive in these two paradigms, because this dimension can help us better understand how men differ in their approach to choosing to work in a woman's career. I would like to illustrate this dimension of activity in the revolving door model and the passivity in the trap door model with the story of Ellie, an Israeli kindergarten teacher, and Radar, the man who we saw the video of. So that's Ellie. When you go into his classroom, you think you've come into a zoo. And so he's got a menagerie there. So what did Ellie do? Ellie followed the classic trajectory of young religious Israeli men by integrating advanced Jewish studies with army duty in a 5-year program. But most men, when they finish their army duty, go to India, Nepal, New Zealand, South America as a way of breathing freedom. Ellie didn't do this. He actively thought about career options and what would be most meaningful in his life, and he decided on a future in education, and this is how he talks about it. I considered informal education or early childhood. I said that I will go for one of those two because here I know that I can influence as an educator, pave the way, put forth values, and not just go into a classroom to say what I have to say and then leave, rather to give something, something beyond reciting lessons. That's the reason I went there. So following the, quote, leanings of my heart, unquote, he chose early childhood over working with youth and informal education. His proactive stance included finding a full tuition scholarship and a college honors program, which enabled him to squeeze a 4-year program into a 3-year program. So one could easily say that Ellie entered through the front door. But since I wrote my book, which was published 2 years ago, Ellie's kindergarten has been turned into a center for early learning science education. Instead of having his own group of children, he hosts groups of other kindergartens on a rotating basis. In his 7 years of teaching, till the time of my interview with him, he had managed to earn a master's degree and a certificate as a mentor for beginning teachers. I see him on this glass escalator. He's kind of moving out of the classroom. He came in through the front door. Is he in the revolving door model? I think that he probably is. And then we have Radar, whose story is really interesting. In contrast, Radar had been working in the field for 11 years in Oslo when I came to observe him. He fell into his job as a nursery caregiver almost by chance. After high school, he moved from his small village in Norway to the big city, where a friend asked him to substitute for her for one day in a daycare center. He agreed, and he discovered that working with children was extremely enjoyable, and this is what he said at the end of the day. I had so much fun playing with the kids, reading books. Suddenly the day was over, and I was thinking, am I actually getting paid for this? And so what happened with Radar? The director of the center quickly recognized his intuitive abilities, which I think you can see from the video, and found him a full-time job. He earned a bachelor's degree in early childhood with the support of the center, was promoted to the position of head teacher in the infant room with a staff of 12. He envisioned his place to be in the classroom for the coming years. Because in Norway, in the daycare centers, when the teacher starts in the infant room and moves up with the children for 5 years. So when you sign on, you're signing on for 5 years. However, at this point in time, this is 2 years later, he has been promoted to the position of assistant director to the daycare center of 150 children. So here again, we see trapdoor, but revolving door in the sense that he's moved out of the classroom and he's moving up, though he's staying in childcare. So to summarize, we see these two models of proactive revolving door approach with Ellie as contrasting to an almost passive role of falling into a trap door, which has led Radar to an intentional career path over the years. So what are the practical implications of these findings about men moving in and choosing the career? One more. So the manner in which men enter the field of early childhood matters. My qualitative study does not offer data about the correlation between the method of entry and work longevity, but for those who are interested in increasing male participation in the early childhood workforce, my study offers some directions for thought. Marketing the field as intrinsically interesting and meaningful may be a limited strategy. For some men who are seeking personal significance, this kind of approach would have an appeal. But for others who are simply looking for a job, the benefits of teaching young children may need to be emphasized in terms of the practical side. So I would say that the instrumental as well as the expressive motivations are both relevant when we think about what we can do to attract men to the field. Second career or late career seekers could prove to be a productive source of candidates, especially in academic settings where training involves a range of ages. We should attempt to expose male students to young children through student teaching opportunities and offers of part-time work. Walking through the front door may attract some job seekers, but the emphasis on male models is crucial. I know that this is the approach in many countries, and I think that the policymakers in my country have much to learn from these endeavors in terms of looking for, I mean, we can take our 40 male kindergarten teachers and make every one of them into a role model for other men, but unfortunately, we're not doing it. So I want to move on to the third area of findings that I'm going to share with you this evening, and that's about constructing professional identity. Caring is central to professionalism for women, especially in women's work. This is Nodding's classic finding in Nell Nodding's was the one who did the basic work about caring many years ago. A continuum of expressions of caring ranges from commitment and relationship at one end to cuddling and mothering at the other end. And coming to terms with the ethos of caring in their professional lives is central to how men construct their professional identity in early learning work. I found among all six informants that each struggled not only with constructing his professional identity, but also with his masculine identity, which is actually intrinsically bound up with his professional identity. And this was a surprise. I was not expecting to find this. I didn't think I was going to be dealing with the question of masculinity at all. I thought I was looking at professionalism, but it just came out. It was there all the time. So Elton, my Japanese-American, his personal narrative was laced with references to the female ideal in early learning, and his own very strong masculine identity, and a resolution of the two. Here are two different quotes he made at different points in the interview. He was talking here about his supervising teacher. Remember I told you he was expecting to be placed in an eighth grade class, and they put him in a kindergarten class? Well, this was his supervising teacher. She wore a linen skirt, which never got dirty, even though she did messy art projects with the children. And she was very motherly. And then what does he say about himself? As a male, you probably bring into the classroom and into the program unique traits. And I don't know if that has to do with demeanor or if it has to do with the way you talk, the words you choose. So this is his insistence that, yeah, I'm a man. This is, I'm not embarrassed about it. You know, I don't wear linen skirts. I'm a man. We'll have a little bit more to say about that in a few minutes. I developed this model, which I want to share with you, about what characterizes this masculine professional identity in early learning. I found this process over and over again, that the man, you call it the bloke, enters the profession, gets his first job. There's a female feminine ideal. The ideal teacher is out there. She's the woman. And then somehow along the way, there's a change in awareness. After they start working, after they start being themselves in the job. And this leads to this kind of very bumpy road to this, what for me for a while was a black box, this masculine professional identity. And I spent a lot of effort trying to unpack what does that mean, this masculine professional identity, which they seem to have adopted and were very comfortable with. And remember, these are all veteran teachers that I'm working with. Well, it has a lot to do with the personal ethos of caring. And how do men show it? Well, there's a variety of ways of men showing this ethos of caring. One is a focus on relationship with children. Another is the looking at the needs of the child rather than the mandates of the curriculum, which I interpret as caring. And I think that they do also. Now, these are in lieu of hugging, kissing, the things that these men felt. There was a variety, but there was certainly, you know, not as comfortable with the usual, or say the female modes of caring as. And so they're doing in different ways. Awareness and immediate response to the children, which I illustrated with the video. Genuine interest in the child's work. Focus right in on what's the child doing, looking at it, talking to the child about it. In my country, the child works and works and works and works, brings this picture or whatever it is to the kindergarten teacher and says, "That's really nice. Put it in your drawer, in your cubby." And that's the extent. But that was not what I saw among the men. And intense eye contact, which was, I think is a compensatory, caring behavior. So, about this personal ethos of caring, I have two quotes to illustrate this. One is from Elton. He says, "I guess I consider myself nurturing, but not very motherly. My style here is pretty direct." So he's contrasting what he says is, okay, so I'm not doing mothering and all this cuddling and hugging, but you know, I care, and it's the way a man cares. It's very direct. And Leon says, "I believe in the importance of forging a really strong connection with the child. I try to enter into their world." And it's my understanding that that's how Leon views caring. That's how he has resolved it. So what about touch? An Israeli colleague who happens to be a veteran teacher of three-year-olds told me once that he loves teaching, he loves his job, but he doesn't think that he's going to be able to remain on the job through his entire career. He says, "I'm not going to retire as a kindergarten teacher." So I said, "Well, why do you say that?" He says, "Well," he was very calm, and he said, "Something's going to happen. Some parent will see me touching a child, hugging a child, sitting a child on my lap, and that's going to be the beginning of the end of my career." And he knows that. He's certain of it. But, you know, he's just going on kind of hoping that it doesn't happen soon. It happens later than sooner. Men who work in early learning are accustomed to living with this cloud of suspicion hanging over them. And they get used to it, and somehow they adapt to it. And so here are some examples of what I saw. There seemed to be an immunity to this fear of touching. That all the six men they weren't afraid to touch the children. They weren't overly expressive, but they, and especially with toddlers, there was a lot more hugging, kissing, speaking gently with the toddlers than with the older children. Gentle encompassing. This is Levine, the Dutch man, who, this is how he would hug children like this, you know, with his kind of a big kind of. And resilience. I think that they've developed a resilience that enables them to use touch in spite of their suspicions and their fears surrounding it. So I'm going to move on to other aspects of this male professional identity, which I think I'm trying to describe. And one component is their attitude towards work, this expression of pleasure and satisfaction. Radar told me, so on my morning bus ride, I think of how happy I am to be going to work in a profession I love, and then what's not written there is, and looking at the people beside me with a frown and a groan, and knowing that they have to sit in an office all day, and that's how lucky I am. And there's this involvement throughout the day, constant involvement with the children. Maybe they were performing for me because I was a researcher from a different place, but the only break they took was the break that was allowed them. They were a 15-minute break, and they were working with the children constantly, 15 minutes and then back. Nonstop interaction, except for allotted breaks, and intense energy. And I think that all of those are expressions of their very, very positive attitude toward their work. Styles of interaction. So in the first part of my talk, I explored pictures of practice of men in early learning. And so I want to return to these pictures of practice with a lens on using the lens of this ethos of caring and show how these characteristic behaviors relate not only to the men's personal ethos of caring, but also to their masculine professional identity. So excuse me if I'm repeating myself here, but I wanted to put it all together in terms of what I see as their styles of interaction, which I found in common between the different men. Very, very child-centered, a lot of charisma. Enjoyed it, focused on promoting thinking, emphasis on physical activity. And some of that was the play, certainly very physical. Encouragement of daring and acts of physical prowess, I'm going to come back to that. Encouraging independence, which I mentioned before. Another aspect of the of their professional masculine identity has to do with how they present themselves. So here's their dress codes, their speech codes, their behavior codes. And these are, of course, culturally bound, and they look very different in the different countries. Most of the men in my study wore jeans and a t-shirt to work. Typical male dress. So I have to say that the women in the same daycare centers and the kindergartens also wore jeans and a t-shirt. So it didn't seem to me as being particularly male, but it was certainly very male. So Elton's style of dress stood out among the others, but it didn't stand out in his own community and his own culture. You can see he's wearing a necktie. Well, what is he doing? He has this, and it's a school, and so he has to wear an ID tag. And he has a lanyard or this kind of string. And so what does it do? It's a football team. It's a university town, and this is an example of an American university emblem, and that kind of emblem is woven into this lanyard. So that's, you know, this is my football team thing. This happens to be a keychain with a beer opener on it. But And then he wore button-down shirt with a necktie. But if we look at the necktie closely, and I did a double take on this, there's his necktie. His necktie has teddy bears on it. So his message is very clear. I'm a man like any other male professional in my town. I go to work with a shirt and tie. Like any other man, I support our local football team. But I'm an early learner's teacher and professional. I have a soft underbelly. And so here are the teddy bears to prove it. So I'm going to come back to this daring. Ellie told me, he said, when a child climbs on a tall chair, a man and a woman will see this situation totally differently regarding their fears. That's what Ellie says. I mean, I don't know if it's true, but that's what he says. That's what he thinks. So encouraging children to daring behavior is really a quintessential male trait in Western societies. I don't want to go beyond what I know. That's what I know. And the men in my study fell right into place by encouraging daring. Levine, my Dutch informant, told me a story about a staff discussion about whether or not to allow children to climb on the roof of the playground playhouse. And he found himself in a minority of one. He was defeated, and the children do not climb on the roof there. There are really interesting developments now in attachment, in the attachment research. Now, the attachment research, which was developed at least 30 years ago, was done on mothers and their children, not on fathers. Those measures that were developed show this basic trust, which has to do with, you know, feeling safe and nothing about daring. But recently, there's been a whole new line of research, attachment research, where they look at fathers. And they've developed these are the researchers, the primary researchers here. They've developed a paradigm called the father-child activation relationship theory. And it has to do with where they see the fathers are activating their child to do daring things. And they see that is a way that children attach to their fathers. The theory posits that fathers achieve attachment differently than mothers achieve attachment by activating their child to try out risky situations and to be there to support the child no matter what happens, which has to do with this throwing the child up in the air and the child lands in the father's arms, and that's where the child attaches to the father. So, again, this throwing the child up in the air looks, it depends on how you view it. And it depends on who's looking. So I thank my colleague in Amsterdam for sharing this with me. His name is Louis Tavecchio. So an aspect related to daring is bravado. It's not the same. This feature relates to nurturing resilience, a desire to develop in the children, both boys and girls, an ability to cope with difficult situations, including pain, sometimes without crying, perhaps in a manly fashion. And this is the most traditional idea of what a man does when he's in pain. He doesn't cry, you bear it out. I'll give you an example from Levine, my Dutch informant, though I have to tell you that my Israeli informant gave me almost exactly the same quote, almost exactly the same situation happened to him. Okay, so what happened was he was putting a thumbtack in the wall, and you call it a thumbtack? In this bulletin board, you had to put up a picture there, and the pin of the thumbtack got stuck in his hand, and so he's bleeding, and so what is he saying? I was saying to the children, okay, now look, and I was smiling, and I said, it hurts, but I don't have to cry. And then his hand's bleeding. So then he goes off to the other class, to the first aid person, and he told the first aid person, I can't get the pen out, could you help me? And then after that, I went back, talked to the children and said, you see, he's holding up his hand again, it was painful, but I don't need to cry, it wasn't that bad. And then I told them this Dutch rhyme, and I don't speak Dutch very well, but pin is fin, blut is good. Pain is nice, blood is okay. It's apparently a classic Dutch thing to say. And as I said, that my Israeli teacher had the same situation. It wasn't a thumbtack, it was a needle or a pin or something, but it was amazing. So let's sum up what I found in terms of elements of male professional ideal. I found this constellation of behaviors, which I've showed you. In a minute, I'll put them up here. Men have differential preferences for these behaviors. They don't all look the same. Some men choose some, and some men choose others. These constellation of behaviors I found across the cultures, though they may look different in different cultures, like the necktie with the teddy bears. And so one is being child-focused, work satisfaction, cautious touch, charisma, physical activity, higher-order thinking, that is encouraging higher-order thinking, daring, independence, encouraging independence among the children, liking to play, and the bravado. And I have this question here, is this a male style of caring? And I happen to think it is. It's something that can be debated. I'm waiting at this point for somebody to stand up in my when I talked about this to other groups and say, yeah, but women, a good female kindergarten teacher is going to do all of those as well. And, you know, it's probably true. But I just found it astounding that it was a commonality among the men. And the female kindergarten teachers I know in Israel, and I know a lot of them, I can say that they exhibit some or the other. They don't, cautious touch, never. And it's always, you know, very, I don't think I know anybody, any women who, in my realm of work, who exhibit all of these. So that's why I've developed this model and thing and suggesting that this is a male style of caring. So let's go back to the model and see the model in a different light with this new information. And here we start with entry into the profession, the female ideal, change in awareness. So with the entry in the into the profession, there's this attraction to the female ideal. Then there's a deconstruction. They deconstruct the feminine ideal. And involved with a change in awareness. And then there's a reconstruction. After you deconstruct, you reconstruct into a masculine ideal. And I'm suggesting with the previous slide what that masculine ideal might be. I may not have gotten it right, but I think there is a masculine ideal. That is, each man holds his masculine ideal. And then at that point, he reclaims his masculine identity that he abandoned in the beginning or left parts of it aside, and now he comes back to it and says, yeah, it's okay to do the things I like to do. And I think that honoring this masculine identity, recognizing it and honoring it, is one of the one aspect of retention of how we're going to keep men in the field. Let's let the men in the field be men in the way they want to be men. And what's my take-home message here? I'm suggesting that constructing a male identity is central to this whole question of men's choosing early childhood as a career. A reason for not choosing is could be one reason. There are many reasons for not choosing, but one reason could be that it's kind of scary. You know, I take go and do this women's work, and what's going to happen to me as a man? You know, can I still be a can I still be the man I want to be? So I think it's really important for all of us to be sensitive towards the different expressions of a male professional identity in whatever form it takes. And I've suggested here some different forms that it may take. And I think this sensitivity is what we need. It's one of the things we need. We need a lot of things, but I would like to see more of it. I think it's really important to help men find their own voice in early learning. they're teaching the way they teach, the way they, let's talk about myself, the way those of us who work with young children like to be with young children may not look like the way a female colleague teaches, but it's important, and we need to support men to find this voice. And lastly, I think that listening to the personal narratives of men who work in early learning is really important in to understand their needs, and also to formulate appropriate policies that include and welcome men into the profession. So. Thank you very much for your attention. I'll just, for those of you who are interested in reading more, this is my book, and I put here some flyers about the book, and the publisher is at the moment is giving a discount, so if anybody interested. So we have some time for questions or comments, or if you have something to say, I'd really be interested in. Yes.
In the places you study the men, how difficult is the early childhood run? Is it state run, or is it more New Zealand? I suppose it's more run. A lot of it's run on a charity basis. It's sort of with the government sort of thing.
Most of the sites I was at were public. The one exception was in Switzerland. The Norway. I'll tell you about Norway in a minute. In Switzerland, it was a synagogue school that conformed to the state program, the state curriculum. In Norway, it's a private daycare centers called Canvas. They run they're like the top of the line daycare centers in Norway, and they're private non-profit, and every daycare center in Norway is funded by the government. So, but it's not government run. The government allows private profit and non-profit organizations to provide the service, and the others were all public. So you're not asking me questions. I'll ask you a question. I'm really interested in your take on this model that I presented here. If you think, does it make sense? Would you do it differently? How does it fit with what you know? Yes.
Thank you for your lovely presentation, and especially the model. It really got me thinking, and I come from Singapore.
Mm-hmm.
We do have men working in early childhood education as well. Mm-hmm. I've been training some of them as well.
Mm-hmm.
My question to you is, since you've seen a lot of men from India, from different countries, men in Singapore, when they work in early childhood, there's a policy written by the government, not the government, by the ministry, that men should never do routine care with kids. They should mm-hmm. never bathe the children. No change of diapers and other little things as well. So, did you face or encounter such things with men when you talk to them?
I was in two nursery rooms, the one in Norway and the one in London, in England. And in both, the men changed the nappies. But in both, it was a very open situation. In Norway, the table where you change the nappies has a, it's like in this room, it's a this, and it's glassed off for hygienic reasons, but everybody can see. Okay. In London, in the daycare center, it's a public daycare center, and it was not like that at all. But Leon changed, and there was not a problem with it. Though in England, they have this, every childcare worker in England goes through a training program of how to touch children. And that means that the child, you don't sit the child in your lap, the child sits beside you. And there are all sorts of rules like that. But in terms of changing, but in other situations, I'll tell you, the kindergarten teacher in Israel, he avoids it. He's working with five-year-olds, but if a child has an accident, then does he go? He avoids it, but if necessary, because he has an aide who's a woman, if necessary, he will do what he needs to do. But he always leaves the door open. And you know, I find that a pretty standard response. Men say that, okay, well, I don't have any problem, you know, helping a child in the toilet, but I'm going to always leave the door open.
It happens back home as well. Mm-hmm. So men are supposed to be at the threshold, and the aide would be helping the kids as well in the toilets. And the other thing is that I've heard men, the teachers telling me that they have this conflict between femininity and masculinity as well, especially at the playground.
Mm-hmm.
We do have this issue, and it really shed a lot of light to me when you were talking about that.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of conflict. They come and tell me, Sakuna, when I'm at the playground, I want children to do these things, but the women out there, they tell me, don't do that. So it's been very difficult to talk to women.
Yeah, well, I think that that's one of the... one of the big issues in men feeling comfortable in the work. I have a colleague in Germany who's doing his doctoral dissertation on gender. He called it gender territory, and he's found that men are actually in the daycare centers, in the kindergartens, not the daycare centers, are marginalized. They're, you know, they give them a screwdriver and say, go fix this, or, you know,
yes,
take care of the
yes.
computer, but just anything but play with the children. And, you know, unfortunately, I mean, don't want to say this across the board because it's not true, but there are many women who find themselves in a situation working with men who are suspicious or they're uncomfortable and they don't like seeing the men play ball with the children. And I mean, it happened to me. My first job as a kindergarten teacher, not first job, as a later job with a kindergarten teacher, I was out there playing American football with the kids. And my colleague, who was she worked with me, said, well, you know, we really don't do that. We don't really play with the children. They need to, but she gave it a different reason. She said the children need to play on their own. It's not right for us to go in and, but, you know, it made me uncomfortable. And I think that's a big issue that we have to work on, is helping women in these, who work with men, to allow the men to be men, to be with children the way they understand they need to be with children. It's a big problem. Yeah.
Going back to your model today, but I think I really like the model, and in fact it's something that we find here in New Zealand quite often. A lot of guys go into centres and they're not quite sure what they're allowed to do or who they should be. And we have had people say, you know, I don't know how to talk to children, and I'll say, well, talk to them like you're talking to me, because they'll worry about doing the wrong thing. and mm-hmm. worried that they're not being the same as everyone else. What I did like about the model was the fact that they do go on and they play, but then they deconstruct. Well, the problems we have, I think, in New Zealand charter centres is the fact that we don't have enough men to have a discussion about these important issues. In New Zealand in the 1980s, there was a lot of work done on gender equality, especially how girls can do everything. And now we've got to 2016, and even though the woman still haven't got hit in the glass ceiling, it's almost like we've done that.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want to go back that way again, you know. And that's, unless we're actually talking about the differences, we won't understand the similarities as well, you know. And it's about that common ground. And I think one of the problems that we have is getting people to believe that by bringing more men into the sector, we actually, we don't replace anything, we add, we bring on richness to ideas and ways of doing things. So it might be American football, for example, as a new thing that kids could do that wouldn't be done before. And that's a bonus. And it's rather than seeing it as a negative thing, and we are aware of also the fact of the career structures won't be revolving doors and people getting out. And of course, one of the problems with men is that proportionally, or disproportionately, they tend to go through the system of quicker, and that does engender a bit of animosity. But I think it's a good problem that we can work with in terms of looking at recruitment and process. It's a process issue, it's not a gender issue. And I think that we need to sort of look at some of those ideals people have in terms of who appoints those people and why are we appointing people on what basis. And mm-hmm. I think we can work on that. But the thing about the deconstruction and the reconstruction is something that's really important, and I think that you nailed on the head before when you said about that just because a man might be really keen on the outdoors, there are lots of men who are not. And I think it's that being aware. And I think teams get that balance. The interesting thing on my career, and I've been in 35 years in ECE, has been everyone I've worked with, to my face, have enjoyed it, and we've really enjoyed both the different genders.
Mm-hmm.
The problem with gender for me has always been the ones above. And tennis, where I found the biggest barriers, people in positions above us, rather than on the team face. I think teams grow, and I think that a lot of females have said they really enjoy having that balance. And
mm-hmm.
that's something that I think that we push that whole thing about. This is an ideal job for men. What men have to do is discover it. And that's the challenge that we have.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good model.
Yeah,
like.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
A lot of private early childhood in New Zealand, I find that there isn't a career structure for teachers. You can go to be a head teacher or manager of the centre, but a lot of them, because they're competitive to be cheaper than the next door company, they tend to put teachers on beginning teacher rate and just leave them there, you know, so that the job as such is, as a teacher, is not really valued. It's, while other parts of early childhood and the government sector is more structured, like primary and secondary teaching, you know, you have a career in teaching.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the competitive side of early childhood in New Zealand that really pushes teachers' wages down to make the money go around, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It's the same thing.
Yeah, we have the same thing in Israel in terms of a lack of professional advancement in early childhood. You could be a teacher, but from being a teacher, there's nothing to move up to. You can be what's called a someone who goes in and helps other teachers, you know, a kind of guidance advisor. But those jobs, they're not better paid, and you have to continue being a teacher. They give you a day off to do this other, and that's it. You can become an inspector, which is, you know, from the British system, but there's one inspector for every 150 teachers, so the chance of moving into that position are almost nil. So there's really nowhere to go. And I think that may be a reason why, you know, men, one of the reasons why men are not attracted to the profession, because, you know, where are they going to go? They're going to just be there, be there, be there. And then in order to move up, you have to move out.
I've been in all those roles and a crap role. I'm about to be a teacher again.
Yeah.
And that's why we go down. And that's the irony, isn't it? That the career structure that we often so seek takes us away from the reason why we came with the sector to begin with, kids. Mm-hmm. And we end up working with adults, which we all know cause problems.
Yeah, right.
So we go back to the kids.
Mm-hmm. I found that and the men told me, and from my own experience as well, that that men tend to go through this initial phase of a bit of suspicion, and then when the parents get to know the man, they love it. And then I have some laboratory kindergartens connected with my college, and I have one male teacher, and his, in the beginning, there were parents who opted out, who wouldn't enroll their child, and 4 years later, the day the enrollment opens, parents are standing in line to get their child, and his kindergarten is fully enrolled within a week, and there's a waiting list. So I think once parents are smart people, then when they see what's really going on, then they make the right choice for their child, and there are parents who prefer that.
Teacher. I've never had a boy teacher. He didn't think it was very fair that every year he is placed in a class with a girl teacher.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's really sweet. Yeah. And it's not necessarily, I didn't interpret my little Edmund as saying a boy teacher is better than a girl teacher. He just wanted a teacher, a chance to have a teacher of his own gender. And the use of the reference of boy rather than male man,
yeah.
You know, is kind of cute. And so I think from a child's perspective too, you know, I find the kids I talk to really get a kick out of having men and women. And they do, they see you as men or boys, and they see women as females and as girls. And, you know, I know early on when I started researching this area, I would have other women, I'd have my colleagues telling me, women can do what men can do. We can wear the trousers. What are you talking about, Sarah? You know? But you talk to kids. Kids do know the difference between boys and girls, men and women, and they don't necessarily see that teachers are any less effective, be they male or female, but they do know that gender's there. And no woman teacher can be a boy teacher, and no boy teacher can be a girl teacher. Kids need both of us, and that's what I find really lovely when I'm sharing with kids. Yeah. So maybe next year my little boy might get a boy. We'll see.
Oh, yes.
I've just recently gone into a permanent position, but as a relieving teacher, I encountered a situation. I have to say, I was in the room when I heard it go on. A mother was not happy by the fact that a male teacher had been employed and he was going to begin changing nappies.
Mm-hmm.
And she was very unhappy by that, and she made it very clear, quite loudly in front of everyone, that he was not to change her child's nappy. A year after I had been at that centre relieving, went back again to relieve as an on-call reliever, and the child had been moved to another centre completely.
Mm-hmm.
Which I thought was very interesting, but I think for me that was the first view into what men encounter and I think it's rotten, really. I think it's it, like, you know, males play such an important role, and even my own experience in primary school, I remember my male teachers very fondly, and I'm very grateful for the fact that I had a chance to have male and female teachers, but that was in primary school.
Mm-hmm.
In kindergarten, I only had female teachers, and I think I missed out, I think. I think having males working alongside a male teacher that I work with, I think it's really wonderful, and I can see how the children respond to him differently as they respond to the rest of us females.
Mm-hmm.
Sort of make up 9 out of 10 teachers, which is, it's a shame, really.
Yeah, but on the other hand, it's probably a good thing that the system was able to meet the needs of this family by finding another placement for this child. I mean, if it's just not going to work, you know, if the parents are going to be so uncomfortable, you're not going to convince those parents, probably.
No, not quite.
They've already made up their minds, right?
She made up her mind very clearly.
Yeah.
She made it very, very loudly.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Writing to do, or whatever it is. But thank you all very much for coming, and thank you to David for sharing your wonderful research. Such a huge amount of information that you've shared with us. And I do hope to see you all again. We will keep talking about near and early childhood education, won't we? And do go back to your services and to your areas of work, and tell others about tonight. And Story Park is kindly making a record of tonight, so we hope to be able to put it online so that you can also share it and other people can watch tonight's proceedings as well. Thank you.
Okay, and when you come to Israel, look me up, get my address from Sarah.